Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja. I hope out there you're wearing your mask. I hope you're sanitizing. I hope you're social distancing because COVID-19 is real. It is still ravaging our society and it does kill. We still need you as a viewer of the Urban TV. Now, on July 31st, the Kabaka of Buganda, Ronald Muwenda Mutebi, will be marking 28 years on the throne since the restoration of traditional and cultural institutions in Uganda. On The Checkpoint tonight, we are delighted to be hosting the Katikkiro of Buganda, Charles Peter Mayiga, OHTBwa. Welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me. And I'm very pleased that you started the show by encouraging people to wear masks, to sanitize. I've got my sanitizer here, and to keep the distance between themselves, to avoid the events and functions, and because what we want for Ugandans is a healthy population. So I'm going to remove my mask, but we've observed all the SOPs, and we encourage the viewers to do the same.
We shall not also hesitate to thank you for sensitizing the community against this pandemic. Initially, there's a lot of misinformation and misgivings about the virus and how it should be handled, but I strongly feel that you're one of the leaders that has strongly been able to support government in sensitizing the masses to understand the virus and also how we can keep it at bay. I think it's a very good job. But OHTBwa, stepping away from COVID-19, this week, we are going to be celebrating 28 years of Kabaka Ronald Muwenda Mutebi II on the throne. As I want to understand the relevance of this coronation, 28 years, especially in the face, I would say, last month, there was an uprising in Eswatini against Muswati, King Muswati. So the question is hereditary leadership still relevant in a global atmosphere that seems to be asking questions about the relevance of this kind of leadership in their lives?
Well, King Muswati of Eswatini is a good friend of the Kingdom of Buganda, and we hope a solution will be found to the challenges that are being experienced in that kingdom right now. Hereditary leadership is about heritage. Every community has characteristics that define them. And we'd not exist in a vacuum. We exist because of the different histories we have experienced over thousands of years. We exist because of the way we lead our lives, because of the cultures we embrace. We do not come from Mars and land on the earth like a asteroid or something like that. We've got lots and lots of elements that define every community. So I think it is very important to have hereditary leadership where it is cherished, because the case for hereditary leadership isn't meant to say that everywhere you are going to have kings or chiefs or even cultural leaders as such. It may not work like that everywhere. The countries which do not have these experiences, and that's okay. But they also have got characteristics that define them. But for those who have them, like the people of Buganda here, or the people of Bunyoro, or Toro, or the people of Eswatini, all the English for that matter, the Dutch, the Spanish, I think it's fine. It makes, I think it sort of concretely tell the story of their lives.
I think one of the issues that comes out very prominently, you've given the example of the Queen in the United Kingdom, and many studies have indicated that perhaps the Queen as an individual is being cherished, but these questions are going to be asked more often and in a much bolder way, probably, God forbid, when the Queen does leave and then you have a new leader. So, are you ready, as Buganda Kingdom, as we mark 28 years, to respond to these questions? The biggest question, especially for those that criticize this kind of leadership, is the question of relevance, especially to the young people who are the majority in society across the board.
Well, I think the institutions which are symbolic of the heritage of a given people must be responsive to the day-to-day needs of the ordinary person. They must be, all over the world. And where they don't do that, people are going to be unhappy. I don't think anyone should deceive us about the UK. Because, yes, they've got complaints about the monarchy and all these things, but I think they are the proudest people about their heritage, those English people. And I do not foresee any changes to its operations, even after Queen Elizabeth, God forbid, dies. I think they will continue cherishing the institution. Of course, they'll have to try to make the institution more responsive to the day-to-day needs of the people. For example, starting around 1992, I think, the Queen started paying taxes, you know, because the far cry was that everybody is paying taxes. While we love the Queen and the monarchy, what about... Yeah,
it would be a good gesture for them to as well.
You know, what about? And she started paying taxes. She wasn't even coerced. She just realized that the institution should contribute to the welfare, the well-being of the people that she leads. So I think that is the key thing, because any culture or any religion that does not respond to the day-to-day needs of the ordinary person eventually becomes stale and maybe irrelevant. So what is key is to ensure that the kingdoms or the chiefdoms or the cultural institutions, incidentally, we are not a cultural institution, we are a kingdom. People talk about cultural institutions. There are cultural institutions of different characteristics. Ours is a kingdom. So the kingdoms must be responsive to the day-to-day needs of the ordinary person. Here I'm talking about things like job creation, fighting poverty, promoting health, promoting education, protecting the environment. These are the kind of things that are very relevant to everyone. And I think every kingdom, every chiefdom, every cultural institution should have a way it responds to all these issues. If and when that happens, we shall have these institutions for a long time to come.
But we shall get to a point where I'll ask whether Buganda Kingdom has been able to respond to the daily needs and of the people of Buganda. But first, I want to understand from you two things. One, what does 28 years of the restoration of the Kingdom of Buganda and the coronation of the Kabaka, Ronald Muwenda Mutebi II, mean, one, to the institution of Buganda, but also secondly to its subjects and Uganda at large?
Mukyasa ky'15 Mugema w'enkima n'amusumikira ekifundikwa.
Now, the Kabaka is sitting on the man-made traditional throne of the Buganda Kabakas. This throne dates way back to the 15th century. Mugera Mugema Omutaka Mugema alamiriza obuzaale bwe.
Gwe tulaba kaakati gwe mukolo gw'okusumikira Ssaabasajja okuva mu bika bya Buganda nga bamulamiriza okufuga abantu be n'obwenkanya.
Which was made by his grandfather, his ancestor. Mugema, Kakabaka, Golugo, Umukono, Ogadio,
Shimikiro Lugoruno,
Ebigambo bino,
Ronadi, Wemuenda Mutebi Wokubiri, Shimikiro Lugoruno, Ngagwe Kabaka Afuga of Uganda.
You Ronald Wemuenda Mutebi Wokubiri, I invest in each background to show that from now onward,
atereze kifundikwa
the Kabaka of Uganda.
Say the year.
Wasa tumomu kaga.
Well, first of all, the restoration of the kingdom was indicative of the need for the rule of law in the country. Because the abolition of the kingdoms in 1967 was an indication that we were falling apart, as it were. Because the Ugandans had agreed that we are going to have the kingdoms where they exist, and we had agreed on how to be governed, and a constitution agreed upon by the people. It could have flaws. All written documents have flaws, but that's what people had agreed on. And then a group of people decide that this is not what is going to happen. So they decide to abolish the kingdom. Now, the restoration is indicative of the need for observing the rule of law. And because this is what the people want, who are you to say that they shouldn't have it? You know? So that is number one. Two, like I started, probably that was the introduction. These institutions just don't exist. They reflect what we believe in. They reflect our history, our heritage, our way of life. So when the monarchy is restored, it's like, yes, it emphasizes that, yes, there is a community of people called Baganda, and they've got a king, and he's on the throne. And that's how we understand them. That's how we define them. It's a proud moment for those who, you know, subscribe to the cultural heritage of Buganda. It's important because if anyone asks someone, why is his name Nsubuga? Why he called Wasajja? You know, we do not simply say that because, you know, 200 years ago there was a Wasajja in my lineage. You give an explanation. You've got a clan. And the clan system is what defines us. And the Kabaka happens to be the head of the clan heads. It's just a long story, and it's summarized by the coronation. And I think it is very, very important and relevant.
Mm. Of course, there are skeptics that have fronted the facade of modernity. That I mean, these are archaic traditions. Why need them for as long as I have my freedom as a human being? But what I want to understand is it possible for humanity as a person, as a leader that has observed human beings? Is it possible for humanity to survive and progress without necessarily understanding and identifying with the root, for example, heritage?
I don't think it's possible. Even those people who don't have kingdoms have a culture. They've got a way of life. There is what you can call the American culture. They don't have a king, but there is what you can describe as the American culture. You know? But for those whose way of life culminates into a kingdom, like in our case, I think it gets a lot easier to define. Look, not everybody will agree with the institutions anywhere in the world. When you read the history of Buganda, we've experienced people committing treason, actually. By this I mean going against the general beliefs and ethos of trying even to destroy the institution, way back even before the colonialists came. That happens everywhere. When you read history, you'll notice this everywhere. It's like religion. People will go against, I mean, the Reformation in the church, you know, Martin Luther King Martin Luther in Germany, King Henry VIII in England. You know, these people are dissenting voices. Whether or not they were valid voices, that's another day. That's a debate for another day. But yes, they rose up and say, no, we don't agree with this. That happens. But overall, like in our case in Buganda, the monarchy plays that relevant part in our way of lives. I mean, I think all of us are modern enough.
Yeah,
but
sure.
Being modern doesn't mean that I don't have a heritage. You know, I don't simply assume the name I have because it sounded good to my father. No. There were reasons why I was given the name that I was given. And you can go on and on and on. You can be modern while at the same time embracing culture and heritage. And who tells you that the Europeans who have monarchies are not modern? You know, I think there is a level of pseudo-intellectualism. People who want to try so hard to sound
sophisticated,
talking about modernity. What does modernity mean? Does modernity sweep away history? I don't see how somebody who is modern doesn't have a history. You know, like I talked about the American culture. They had their independence in 1776. You know, and even before then, they go back so many years, starting with the days of the explorers and the adventurists from Europe. They've got the history of the natives within America. All that can be summed up as the American culture, as you want. If it doesn't culminate into a kingdom, that's their story. Ours, here in Buganda, it culminates into a kingdom. But I think there are lots and lots of modern people who embrace culture at the same time. What does being modern mean anyway? I don't even understand what they mean by that.
But when the kingdom was restored in 1993, you were the administrative secretary of the Sabataka Supreme Council. Yes. From you to the viewers, what is it that stuck in your mind about this restoration that is still relevant to date and you would say has been able to help the kingdom progress from 1993, when there were skeptics that thought that probably this kingdom would be no more after 1-2 years, but here we are, 28 years.
What stuck with me is what I witnessed in Naggalabi Buddo. Because I don't think up that time, well, I was still young, but I don't think I'd ever seen such a crowd. I don't think I had ever witnessed such happiness. I don't think. And probably even up to now, I don't know whether I've ever witnessed such happiness. I've seen crowds in Namugong, especially on the 3rd of June. I've witnessed crowds at the Kabaka's wedding. Actually, probably the crowd at the Kabaka's wedding was bigger than the one in Naggalabi, I don't know. But the happiness, the joy, the sense of contentedness on the faces of the people. This one will live with me all my life. I think just goes to show that you cannot suppress people all the time. I think that was what the people were expressing on the 31st of July, 1993. Because nothing prepared me for what I witnessed on that day in Naggalabi Buddo, much as I was the administrative secretary. Actually, I was the secretary to the organizing committee. I was pretty much involved in everything that was organized on that.
So that means even you, as an organizing committee then, you weren't sure of what you were about to face.
Well, look, I'd never seen a Kabaka in my life. Well, like, when Kabaka Mutesa, you know, fled to England, I was born, but I was just a baby. And I never saw him. But of course, I saw Kabaka Mutebi was being referred to as Sabataka then. From 1990, I saw him from the time he came back from exile, 1986, but from a distance. But then I saw the Vika football, huge crowds, but well, I don't know. Maybe I thought people were coming to enjoy football. I didn't know. So I'd never seen a Kabaka until the 31st of July, you know, a fully enthroned Kabaka, and nothing prepared me for what I witnessed. So it stuck with me. And by the way, the frenzy, the frenzy from the press, because we had 300 news outlets accredited for the event, including CNN, all these international broadcasters were there. So it was a big thing, and whoever witnessed it, like I did, is lucky, I think, even if for purposes of history alone.
but of course, it wasn't a smooth ride. One of the things that I observed in my reading of the history is that the scheduled date was 24th July, but then it was moved to 31st July. What are some of these key impediments that could have hindered that? Because by 1986, in your book you write that no sooner had Museveni taken office before he even settled into Entebbe, the agitation was already up for the restoration of the Kabakaship. But it took 7 years, and even after the 7 years, in 93, it took another extension, postponement upon postponement. What are some of these key impediments that came out, and what did they really mean?
Well, the people of Buganda participated in the Luwero War, and for the vast majority of them, it was about the monarchy, really, and the rule of law. Because, you know, I think the 1980 elections were rigged. Anyone who is honest enough must acknowledge that. And of course, Milton Obote became president a second time, and he's the one who had abolished the monarchy. So it was fairly easy for anyone to recruit fighters from within Buganda. I think that's the basic reason the Bush War started in Luwero. But also, we must acknowledge it's not very far away from Kampala. But I think the most important thing was that the fighters were warmly received. So the Buganda were sort of partners with the other fighters. People may not want to acknowledge that these days, but that's the reality. And you know, history is history. So soon after the NRM was the NRA captured Kampala, and the elders started telling the president that, yes, we fought with you, but we've got a king in waiting. And of course, it wasn't going to come on a silver platter. And at one point they were saying, yeah, the prince can come back to Uganda as any other person is free to come back to Uganda. In fact, one time on UTV, I watched a news bulletin. It was being read by a gentleman called Sidney Jingo. I don't know whether he still exists. He called the Kabaka Mr. Ronald Mutebi. And then, of course, the monarch hadn't been restored. I found it awkward, but because it was a prince anyway. But that's what he said on the national broadcaster. And there were attempts to make him an ambassador, a roving ambassador. There were all sorts of things. But kings are not ambassadors. Kings are kings. And when he returned, there were many people who were opposed to the restoration of the monarchy within the ruling group. But there was also a major impediment when some lawyers went to court and petitioned the constitutional court, trying to challenge the programs that were being worked out for the restoration of the monarchy. There are vast challenges. There are vast challenges. Then, of course, our properties were occupied. Bulang, for example, was the military headquarters. Somebody burnt it in 1992, I think, to cover up their tracks after they had stolen huge amounts of money. And the palace in Mengo was a barracks. Butikiro was the headquarters of the military intelligence or something like that. So it was an arduous task, reversing all these things. Big challenges. Yeah.
So 28 years later, what do you say as the premier? What do you say are the challenges and threats for Buganda as we stand now?
Well, the challenges are many. First of all, like I said in the beginning, how do you make this institution, this monarchy, relevant to the ordinary person within Buganda? I think that's the biggest challenge. Why? Because the people who clamored for the restoration of the monarchy are the ordinary people. And they must view it as an institution that resonates with their desires, their aspirations. I think that has been possibly the biggest challenge. People talk about the political challenges, but I think that is the biggest challenge. How does the man in Kanabukuriro, down deep in Budu, feel that this kingdom is relevant today in the 21st century? I think that is the most challenging thing, because you're talking about the initiatives, the programs we draw up, the resources that enable us to execute those programs. It's an enormous task. You talked about young people, and they're in the majority. How do they identify themselves with the kingdom? It's a big challenge. I think that's the biggest, because the moment the ordinary person identifies with the kingdom, the political challenges become a little bit weak. If the people, the man working in the market, the border rider, the farmer in the village, the taxi driver, if those people don't identify with the kingdom, well, that would be trouble for the kingdom. Much bigger than the trouble that can come from the politicians. That's my assessment. And we've been working on that in the last 28 years. First of all, the Kabaka dedicated his reign to the youth. I think this was, I could even say, prophetic. I don't know how God... I don't know how God gave the Kabaka this kind of insight, this kind of wisdom. And I think the biggest, the strongest pillar for the monarchy are the young people. The strongest pillar for the monarchy are young people. But as you may understand, it is not enough for this reign to be dedicated to the young people. They must feel it. Do we feel the pain they go through? Do we address the challenges they have? Have we tried to find them jobs? Have we tried to fight poverty? Have we tried to, give them employment? Have we tried to show them the way? Because it's not about giving them employment all the time. It's about showing them the way. Have we tried to do that? I think the Kabaka has scored highly in that area.
And the land question?
The land question.
You don't think it's a threat to...
It's a big challenge, but look, the land is here. I'm seated here on my grounds in my home. Somebody can come and kick me out of here, but they can never carry this ground from here. And if I've got the claim of right on this piece of land, you can take it away from me when you have the power. I'll take it from you when you no longer have the power. It's that simple. I went to Zanzibar
about 5-6 years ago.
And the Zanzibaris, who were kicked out of their properties in 1964, following the so-called revolution of Field Marshal John Okello, he was a Ugandan, I think he was murdered by Idi Amin. They were back, their grandchildren were back from all over Europe, from the Arab world, saying, this property is mine. So yes, we get disturbances when all sorts of utterances are made. But where is anyone going to carry this land? What is important is for people to understand, why do we have all these emotions and attachment to land? If people understand that, yeah, it's a disturbance, but how far can it go? Even after 50 years, if you kick me out of here, I'll come back and claim my house.
So what happens to you if someone unfairly kicks you out and you're 50 years out in the cold? Doesn't that turn you into
there are serious consequences.
Mm. OHTWA, let's go for a very short break.